Quentin Danona to stand before you and share God's word. And why it's such an honor, it's because it's not about me, it's about him. So if you came expecting from God, he'll bless you. And this is my prayer, that none of us will live the same. I like the way our brother Nzuki said that as he was praying for us, that he asked God that none of us will live the same. And I echo that prayer, my brother. That is my prayer this morning. In fact, I'm sure, I don't know how many of you know this writer, motivational speaker, preacher, name it. His name is Zig Ziglar. I had his testimony one time, and this would be my prayer this morning. And he said he went to preach somewhere, and he passed by a beggar. And the beggar was asking for handouts, and he had kept a packet of pencils. So you would donate something, and he would give you a pencil, the beggar. And people were donating as they walked by. And he decided to do the same. And he donated something. And he walked away. But after going a few steps, he decided to come back to the beggar. And he donated, but he never wanted to be given a pencil. So he went back to the beggar and said, "Can I have my pencil?" He was given the pencil. And then he looked at this beggar and he told him, "From today, I've changed your name. You are no longer a beggar, but a businessman." And that was it. Then later on, after a number of years, he went to a certain state to give a talk. And after a talk, somebody came who was very smart. And he wanted to greet him and said, "I know you may not remember me. My name is so-and-so. You visited us in this city. And you told me that from today, from that day, I should stop calling myself a beggar, but instead call myself a businessman." I took that word, ran with it, and I am here to tell you, I became a businessman, and I don't only have one branch, I've got several branches. Just one word. This is my prayer this morning. Forget about many things that will be said. If you can only pick one that can change your life, I'll feel fulfilled and I'll be blessed. Praise the Lord. Therefore, this is my prayer, that you open up your spirit and allow God to bless you. And let me tell you, whatever it is that you hold is so personalized, and I want you to ignore your neighbor for the next few minutes. Allow them, don't empower them to distract your attention. And I'm sure majority of you have seen this quote which has been going around in the social media, which is saying, life is the most difficult exam. Many people fail because they try to copy others, not realizing that everyone has a different question paper. I am here to tell you this morning, you don't know your neighbor's need. Stop copying the answers there, because your question paper is different. Praise the Lord. And that's why for the next few minutes, I want you to ignore those who are your neighbors. Concentrate with your exam paper. The questions are different. You will fail. Our lecturer used to tell us, you answer the question I've asked you. Students are fond of, if you realize you don't know what the lecturer has asked you, you write your own things, the ones you know and you are remembering. Good lecturers just draw lines or they write, I don't know why they like using red, but they say irrelevant. I pray that you'll be relevant this morning and the word of God will be relevant. Praise the Lord. This year, we had a great theme, that this is the year of great exploits. Thank God on Wednesday, we entered the final quarter. Tell your neighbor the final quarter. And by the grace of God from January, we have continued to receive mighty prophets. They came when you were on fire. You were exalted. I don't know how far we are with your exploits. Remember, his exploits doesn't have to be your exploits. You have your definition of exploits. But this morning, I also know I'm talking to some category of people who are wondering. I'm seeing others being blessed. How come has God forgotten my address? I'm here to tell you that he hasn't. If he had, you wouldn't be here. Just the fact that you are seated and listening to me is a confirmation that you are very much in his agenda. And the year still remains the year of exploits. And I pray that this morning you grasp a word from the Lord, which might usher you to the kind of level of exploits you're expecting God to give you. Because I know the definition again. Did you know that even the exploits you are looking for, there is difference at the faces which are looking at me right now. They're as different as our names. It is you to know what exactly. If you enter somewhere and you don't know what you are doing here, one, you'd rather be doing nothing or be doing the wrong thing. I pray that you'll be doing the right thing because you know who you are. I like that song, I Know Whom I Am. If you know who you are, you'll pick that which is relevant for you and you will be blessed. Praise the Lord. Let's start here. Maybe you can project for me Isaiah 48 verse 17. Isaiah 48 verse 17, you can project it for us. Good one, Itabo. Yes. Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer. I am the Lord, your God, who teaches you to profit, who leads you by the way you should go. That is the starting point, that the Lord God is your teacher. And he's not just teaching anyhow. He's teaching you how to profit. I am sure I'm talking to people who love profit. Business people, we love profit. All of us, we want something profitable. We want profitable labor. We want God to help us to make profit. Profit will push you to the next level. Profit will expand your business. And it is the Lord who is the teacher. He teaches you. Once the teacher teaches, that's the teaching. Who implements? Who is supposed to understand? So if the students fail, is the problem the teacher or the students? The students, eh? Praise the Lord. And as I was looking back, reflecting back, sometimes it's good. By the way, I saw it somewhere. If you want to know whether whatever you are sharing is good, two things you should ever always check. Tell the neighbor two things. One, whatever you are sharing, is it making God look a hero? If it is making God look a hero, you're on the right track. Mark number two. Is that speaking to you? If it is not relevant to you, you have no business coming to tell us. Therefore, as I was preparing for today, it was speaking to me, and I kept on reflecting back. And I was telling God, I need it too. And I want us together to read from the book of 2 Timothy 4, 16 and 17. Maybe you can project it for us. 2 Timothy. Remember where we read and I said it is God who is teaching us to profit. And you also agreed that we all want profitable labor. Actually, it's very boring to do a work which has no profit. It's very boring, very frustrating. We don't want to be frustrated. Second Timothy 3, 16 and 17. Sorry, it is 3. Yes, thank you. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Verse 17. So that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That is NIV. Maybe you can project it for us in King James Version, New King James, the same verse. Let's read together. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Remember, I told you today I want us really to feature on prophet, choices for prophet. We all want to be, we all want prophet. And we have just read that all scripture is God-breathed and is useful. It is profitable. In King James, it's saying it is profitable. In NIV, it's saying it is useful for four things: for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training. One, let's agree, it is the word of God. God is the teacher. We all want to be blessed. We all want profitable businesses, ventures. You want to thrive. You want exploits. Remember that if you want, you have to present yourself to the teacher, to the relevant lecturer. Do you know you can be in the wrong class? Have you ever gone, especially in public universities, where you don't have sometimes a permanent class? You go, you look at your classmates, and you realize you are actually in the wrong class. Do I have a witness? Have you ever opened a door, especially when you are late, and to keep time? Because when you arrive early, you are able to master around. Example, it would be, there are only three ways to arrive somewhere. One, you arrive earlier, you arrive on time, or you arrive late. Go and do if you arrive late. Because sometimes you arrive late, frustrated, depressed. Why are you looking at me like you didn't arrive to the office late, the boss didn't want to see you, and then you are frustrated? Next time, aim at arriving on time. Or at before time or on time. You'll always be on the right, in the right atmosphere. You know, people watch you when you come late and they are wondering, now she's so worked up, and you're the one who came late. But as if you were. I say it. It is God who teaches us to profit. God is the teacher. And God has got his course book. And that's what we have just learned, that all scripture is given by inspiration and it is profitable for four things: teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training. And even as I'm talking right now, it is only you, because your question paper doesn't look like your neighbor's, it is only you who will determine whether was God teaching me, was God rebuking me, is God correcting me, is God training me? You are the one who will decide. But one thing I am sure is that you belong to one of those categories. You must fall somewhere. Because you know, it looks like we are classmates. We all came for service. Tell your neighbor, we came for service. Yeah. And even when you go for service, they do different things. Yeah. Because we are all different. The fact that you are listening to me, you came for service. You are a great brother, a great sister. You came for service. And I can assure you the teacher will service you. Praise the Lord. And therefore, very quickly, I want us to talk about four things we have just read that God will do for us this morning. And it is upon you to decide where, because we want to be taught how to profit. Four things. Number one, teaching. Effective teaching requires leading, understanding, storing in the memory, so that you are able to answer the question. Let me tell you something. When we are doing exams, oh my God, the way we read, we want to transfer it from the book to the head. I know that you usually tell us not to memorize, but now how do I retrieve it if it's not here? The issue is you understand. The good thing is you are listen to the teacher. Then you read, you understand. When you come to concentrate, you are able to retrieve and make it relevant. What you confuse is when you try to memorize and you have not understood. You might end up telling the teacher what he actually didn't tell you, ask you. Because you are so quick to answer questions you are not asked. And I know sometimes we have found ourselves doing the same things. You're answering questions you have not been asked. Could that be because you never listened, therefore you never understood? And therefore this morning, I want to encourage somebody. We are in the last quarter of the year. I hope you have been a faithful student in that class of God. You have a relationship with Him. You can remember what He told you last Sunday. And that's why I told you, even if it will be only one, remember that if it can transform you, that's why you can go somewhere and somebody can give you a testimony. That I went to that church. The preacher shared this. I took this one and ran with it. I did this and my life has not been the same again. You did what you needed to do. You transform it and it becomes you. Somebody asked, which is the right translation of the Bible? There's NIV. There's Living Translation. Which other one, tell me? Message Bible, another one? Amplified, another one? Good students. And maybe you wonder, which one is the best? Can I tell you the right one? That one that spoke to you and you changed, and changed your behavior. That behavior, that is the right translation of the Bible. The one that is ministering to you. Forget when it was thou and thee, it is okay. If it ministered to you, changed you, and your life became profitable, run with that one. That one is the right translation of the Bible. Therefore, it looks like if you are going to remain profitable and relevant, understanding the Bible, memorizing the Bible, and following what the teacher is saying, you just have to develop a strategy to read the Word of God. For example, book by book. Somebody told me some of us are experts in using the strategy which is called skim and dip. Yeah, the end up where you just open and you read and that is it. Let me tell you something. You go to class and you adapt that strategy, you'll be very irrelevant and you will fail. Sometimes I wonder, lecturers, are they masterful? But you know they can't mark right when it's wrong. Therefore, I'm saying you have to come up with a strategy to ensure you are positioned for profit. It can be book by book. It can be topical. It can be a theme of the Bible that I want to learn about obedience. Where is it that I'm missing the ring? Others seem to be impressed. I want to challenge you. Are you a faithful student of the Word? And that is why, if you understand it, that is why you will know. This one I have read today, was it a teaching? Was it a rebuke? Was it a correction? Or is it a training? You are able to position yourself somewhere. And you see, when you allow yourself to be taught, meditation, for you to understand meditation, you ask yourself several questions. And no wonder, meditation is one of us. One aspect of being taught that God has attached the key to success and prosperity. In the book of Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, maybe it can be projected for us. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For when you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Meditation. You want profit. There is an attachment. Terms and conditions apply that you have to meditate on it. Therefore, did you know you can't fast track God speak to me quickly. I'm learning late. You won't. It will mean you sit down and listen. And ask yourself a few things. And then you will be prosperous and you will be successful. There is an attachment. Meditation. it can be compared to how cows chew cud. It is in the chewing which we can equate meditation, where grass is converted to milk. The cow will take grass, sit down, chew the cud. In the evening, you are a farmer, a lot of milk. It is in chewing, in meditating the word of God, the teacher, that you will be profitable. And where we started, we said, as you do that, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Are you equipped for everything that you are doing? Could it be you have not been meditating on the word of God? And you know, it is for your own good. Once you memorize, you are able to retrieve it anytime, anywhere, night or day, walking or driving. You can retrieve the relevant word and use it for your situation. Can I tell you, I discovered majority, especially grown-ups, and this is a lie from the devil, we have come to believe, okay, I'm included, that I'm not good in memorizing. But I wondered, how can you, the devil, convince me that I cannot memorize? Yet I went to school and I passed the exams. If it was not in the memory, would I have been able to answer the question? Can you imagine if you adopted a strategy of memorizing only one verse per week? How many memory verses would you have by the end of the year? 52. Are you sure you can say to me 52 verses? Because the devil has lied to you. Because he knows there is an attack, there is a key attached to that, keeping it in your head, that you cannot memorize. You can. How come you remember details about where you come from? And some of you are so passionate when you go to tell us from your village and the things you used to do when you were young, and you can call and give a story. You to have memorized it, you can also memorize the word of God.
Amen.
And therefore today, I am here to tell you, it is not optional. You want profit? You want to be thoroughly equipped for every good work? Meditating on the word of God and memorizing it is not optional. And you know what? Once you have it at your fingertips, you won't be surprised in your home cell if you have to share something. At least you have got one verse in a week. By the way, that is the minimum. You can decide to have it a day. But you can start small as you pursue there. But I'm here to tell you, could that be? Because you decided you don't want to disturb your memory. And God has given it. And it has got a lot of empty space. Could it be that is why you are not yet there? Your exploits are not yet there? Because something, a circumstance shows up, you have no weapon. Number two, what all scripture, we agree it is God inspired, it's God breathed. Something else you have to allow the word of God to do to you. Can you allow the word of God to rebuke you? The word of God is meant to reprimand us, disapprove our actions. When we fail to know what the word of God says, we continue to live in ignorance. You have no idea. You don't read. You don't meditate. You don't memorize. You don't know. You find yourself reading other people's question papers. And it won't work out. You have to allow the word of God to rebuke you. Because it is when you are rebuked, it leads to the that thing, which is correction. Thank God for the word of God. It does not only rebuke you, it tells you how to make right the wrong. It removes the errors from, you know, correcting is removing errors from something, rectifying imperfections, modifying our behaviors to make us acceptable and bring glory to God. Remember where we read that the word of God thoroughly equips you. Could it be you are so unequipped that you don't know. Something presents itself. You want to do what so and so said she did or he did. Remember, your question was different. It doesn't work. It backfires. And some of you, you hear them say, I wonder what is wrong with me. It is true, something could be wrong with you. And today I'm just trying to draw insights to you. What could it be? Have you allowed the word of God to rebuke you and to correct you? Are you rebukable? Are you correctable? You know, some of us, you refuse. The word of God tells you are wrong, you insist you are right. Now I wonder who will win. Number four. The fourth thing. Four. I said teaching. I said rebuking. I said correcting. And I'm in number four, which is training. I was preparing, I thought, what's the difference between teaching and training? When we come to the training aspect, God equips you with the relevant skills. It has to do with the skills. It has to do with some positive habits. You are taught, you start practicing it, you start reading it daily, then you are empowered. You have put a system in place. You have the skill, the training bit. It instructs us on how we can perfect our walk with God. Remember, I said the responsibility of doing all these things is on me. It's on you. Tell your neighbor, it's on you. You know, it's more comfortable when you are telling the other person because you don't want to be, you know. So tell your neighbor, it's on you. Tell the other neighbor on your side, the responsibility is yours. That one makes you feel better. But at least you're also told. So you also know it is on you. And very quickly, I want to talk about one family as I wind up. One family and the different characters had opportunities for any of the above. There was the opportunity of teaching, rebuking, and depending on your choice, there was prophet or Ross. Tell your neighbor, prophet or Ross. And I want us, very quickly, as I said, just a few things regarding this story. I want us to read the book, or to project for us, the book of Ruth, chapter 1. And we read verse 1 to 5. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to dwell in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech. The name of his wife was Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Maron and Chilion. Of Bethlehem, Judah. And they went to the country of Moab and remained there. Verse 3. Then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her two sons. Now they took wives of the women of Moab. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth, and they dwelt there about 10 years. Then both Maron and Chilion also died. So the woman survived her two sons and her husband. This was a family of four. The head of the family made a decision. I like the way it starts. That this, no wonder the book of Ruth comes immediately after the book of Judges. And in Judges 21, the Bible talks, there's one verse which is very sad in the Bible. That during the days of the Judges, everyone did whatever they thought was right, which was very sad. And it is in these times that the book of Ruth comes into scene. And there is this family which is talked about. And the head of this family was Abimelech. One, in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 23, God had forbidden intermarriages, the children of Israel going to Moab and intermarrying with the Moabites. But here, Abimelech, who is the head of the family, makes a choice. He knew what was right. But the circumstances surrounding him forced him. There was a famine. And many a times we make the wrong choices because of what is surrounding us. And you look for a shortcut. That shortcut can cut you. The shortcut, somebody says, you make choices, and all of a sudden, they turn around and they start making you. Abimelech made this choice of relocating his family, his wife and two sons, to Moab, where they had been taught, and they had been told it's wrong. He did it. And he justified the sin, the decision, by the fact that there was famine. Yet, where he came from, the Bible says that Bethlehem means the house of bread. And here I want us to pick one lesson. That you tell people about how great your God is. How able your God is. And when an opportunity presents itself, you want to look for a shortcut. And I want us very quickly to make a few observations about Abimelech. Now, observation number one. As a head of the family, he decided to relocate his family to Moab, although he knew they had been told to keep off from Moab and the people of Moab. Observation number two. Abimelech died in Moab. Let me tell you something. Death is a guarantee, but the place where you die can raise issues. For example, if today you came, I am here, I am not dead, and you are told, Alice Kimani is dead and she was found at Makuti. Her body was found at Makuti. The Bible talks about that it is appointed. Death is an appointment. And it is done. It's still done. But when you die, it also matters. Because it will leave you with many questions than answers. True? You'll be asking yourself, what had she gone to do with Makuti? Was she with Baba Nyambura? Was she with Baba Mungai? Was she, you know? So it matters. And it is recorded, Abimelech died where? In Moab. So it matters even where you go. What happens may be the normal, but even where it also matters. Observation number three. It goes without saying that to some extent, he enhanced the death of his two sons. He positioned the two to an environment that was not in line with God's instructions. And I'm here to talk to the head of families that your decisions will affect you, will affect your wife, will affect your children, will affect your neighbors, will affect your church. It matters what you decide. Abimelech made one decision and everybody followed. And you can see what happened. He died, his sons died, his wife became a widow. His daughters-in-law became widows. So it matters. He had been taught. He decided to ignore the teaching. Tell your neighbor, don't ignore God's teaching. Character number two is Naomi. And I want to read a quote. Maybe somebody can project it for us. A quote I picked somewhere. It says, when you encounter uncomfortable situations, you can either decide to be victim or an overcomer. Always choose to be an overcomer. Grace is within our reach to be overcomers. Why did I pick this quote? Because it is true, Naomi followed the husband. And she agreed that they relocate to Moab with her husband, Abimelech. Abimelech. Although she knew it was against the will of God. We are not told she raised any concern. You know, let me talk to the ladies here. You are meant to be helpers. Next time he tells you, let's come to the hall. Maybe you can tell him, can we put some water? At least the water will reduce the magnitude, okay? I'm trying to say you are meant to be a helper. At least it's not recorded that Naomi tried to tell Abimelech told not to relocate to Moab. Had we wait here? And you know, because the two are one, you also bear the consequences. And a very good story is in the New Testament, where Ananias and Sapphira, when the wife came late, Peter asked her, "It looks like you and your husband agreed to write to the Holy Spirit. So you can choose to be a victim or choose to correct the situation." My prayer this morning is this, that you can resist praying a brain game. Maybe if there was that opportunity in the Bible, we asked Sapphira what happened, she can either take responsibility that I should have at least told the truth, or she can say, "It is my husband. You know he leads, I follow. Not in everything, especially when it comes to the things of the kingdom." So Naomi never questioned the husband's decision. But later on, I know we know the story. Naomi decided to go back to Bethlehem. The Bible says in the book of Ruth that there was bread in Bethlehem, and she made a decision to go back. She decided to make right the wrong they had made. When she decided to, she agreed to be corrected. I want you to watch her graph. From that point on, when she decided, as long as she was in Moab, the husband died. The sons died. We don't know what else would have happened. But she decided an about turn, and her start started rising. I'm here to talk to somebody. Can you allow the word of God to correct you? Are you correctable? Before your star, like Naomi's, can start changing. She also made another decision. She decided to encourage her daughter-in-law, Ruth, to go leaping and offer guidance to which particular field. Life is about choices. She counseled her daughter-in-law on how to connect with the boss. Her choices made her become the grandmother of a son of destiny. When you agree, you allow the word of God to speak to you, to correct, to rebuke you, to correct you and train you, you can make such a turnaround. The other character is Ruth. And I want you to note a few observations about Ruth. Ruth was a foreigner. Maybe she would say, that is a translation from my mother tongue. She was a Moab. And here comes brothers from Bethlehem. And one of the brothers happens to ask for a happy marriage. And Ruth, being a foreigner, she said yes. And she made several choices that changed her destiny. She was a foreigner, but because of the choices she made, her destiny was changed. One, she agreed to marry a Jew. She decided to follow her mother-in-law in spite of her circumstances. I want to believe maybe she had observed a few things. These people who came from Bethlehem, they don't behave like us, and I like their behavior. And this is why, in spite of them being widows, she said, "I'll still choose this widow. She seems to have something I don't have." She decided to go reaping, although she knew none of the harvesters. It was daring, it was risky. Imagine, you are a foreigner, you know nobody, and you decide to take the risk. She made several choices, several decisions that changed her destiny and shaped her destiny. She decided to be married by Boaz. You know, when she agreed to be counseled by the mother-in-law, and she was asked what to do, and she did it the right way. Let me tell you, it is so surprising. We are not told the age of Boaz, but from what is written, he looks like he was a senior bachelor. But when the first time she saw Ruth, she said, "My daughter." She kept on referring her to my daughter. And she was saying, "My daughter." At some point, the story changed. She stopped being a daughter and became a wife. And you know, because of the wise decisions she made, she was teachable. She allowed her mother-in-law to teach her. The outcome is she got married to a rich man after having been a widow. Praise the Lord. You know, you are a widow. Your mother-in-law is a widow. You are a foreigner. But she got so blessed that she got married to a very rich man, a senior bachelor called Boaz. And you know, because she was teachable, she became the owner of the land where she used to follow the harvesters. Yes, when you become teachable, the Lord will teach you to be profitable. And you'll be thoroughly equipped. I'm here to encourage you to become teachable, to become rebukable, correctable, trainable. And you have something to show for the hard work of their labor. And of course, she ultimately became the grandmother of the child of destiny. Praise God. This morning, I don't know at what level you are. I want to tell you, it doesn't matter how far. Maybe you don't even know the Lord Jesus Christ. You would count yourself a foreigner. I am here to tell you, the word of God is here to thoroughly equip you. And you can become an owner like Ruth. Of course, there are the other characters, the sons, Maron, Gideon, and Ophir. Those are the silent characters of the story. And you know what? What we know about Maron and Gideon is that they got married and they died. And they died in Moab. Remember what I told you, even when you die, matters. It has a story. An untold story. Boaz, much as he was remember, this story is coming about during the times of the judges, where there was no order in Israel. But it looks like this brother, much as he was a senior bachelor, he feared God. Even when Naomi made a plan with her daughter Ruth. And he discovered in the middle of the night that there was a sister down there. The Bible talks about, he only asked, who are you? You can find yourself in the wrong corner. But because you have kept the word. The Bible says that the word of the Lord, I have hidden it, that I may not sin against him. You will be able to say no. You will be able to keep to boundaries. And you can see Boaz maintained his boundaries until he was given the green light to redeem Ruth, Naomi, and everybody of that clan. He remained straight. You can remain straight. Who said you are late? He was a senior bachelor. But you know what? By the grace of God, even during that time when people would think he is late, he became the father of a son of destiny. It doesn't matter where you are. Fear God. He was a kind man. Very kind. And I think they started connecting with Ruth somehow, somewhere. Because the Bible says, as Ruth was following the reapers, this owner showed up. And asked, whose girl is that? And she was told. Actually, he was so kind. I think God started connecting them, but they didn't know. Praise God. But all we know, he was senior in age, but when God visited him, he did about him. It doesn't matter what they are saying. I told you, I started by telling you your question paper is different. They will be surprised. Things could be going on behind. But when God gives the answers, you become a real testimony. Today we can talk about Ruth, who was a foreigner. We can talk about Boaz, who was a senior bachelor. We can talk about Naomi. Naomi was so affected, she had even proposed that they change her name. Don't call me Naomi, call me Peter. She was widowed. She was sonless, and she was even despising the daughters-in-law. Go back to your mothers. Have you ever read the spirit of the wives? Lord, Naomi was bitter. She was telling her daughters-in-law, now why are you following me? Are you sure even if today I got married, I can get sons, and you wait for them, they will marry you, and you get children. You know she was trying to show them how impossible it is. But I'm here to tell you this morning, when God is teaching you to profit, it is possible. Amen. It doesn't matter. It is possible. And according to the word of God, today, I said you are the one who will pick what is relevant. What is it that God has been telling you to stop? And you have insisted and justified that it is okay. Can you imagine a scenario where you find a warning telling you, deep, keep off. And you look at it and say, deep? This one is irrelevant. I have been here long enough and you jump. Let me tell you, you make a choice, consequences are automatic. The word of God tells you this is wrong. You insist it is right. If I were you, I would tell God to help me to be teachable, to be rebukable, to be correctable and trainable, and you are assured of profit. And maybe you are wondering how you can apply whatever we have been sharing this morning. How you can apply. And I'm here to tell you, allow God to instruct you through His word every day. And hide the word in your heart. Because if you do not make God number one, something else or someone else will be number one. And you know, the Bible equates the word of God that the word of God is a lamp at your feet. I want you to imagine you entering a room and you decide you are not going to put on the right. You can imagine the wonders that will happen in that room. It is during the night, you enter the room, and you decide you not put on the right. And unfortunately, a number of us, you wake up to a day which is protested with so many things and many decisions to be made. And you don't want the word of God to become a right to your feet. You are actually walking in darkness. Psalms 119 verse 18 says, Psalms 119 verse 18 says, open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your Lord. This is my prayer this morning, that each one of us, every day, you can tell God, open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your Lord. You can't see if you are not reading. And that is how you will be thoroughly equipped. You ignore God's warnings at your own risk. But it is never too late to turn around to God and make peace with Him. Scars will still show, but you no longer be bitter. And you will use the same scars to give others hope. You know, much as Ruth got married to Boaz, she still had the scar. Once upon a time, she used to be Mrs. Maron. She still, you know, you can't rub your history. But she can give a testimony and say, I was a foreigner. I chose this woman. I chose her God. I chose where to live. And I met the man of my dream in that place. And I became the mother of the child of destiny. The scars could still remain, but you use them to lift up the name of Jesus. I am here to encourage you, wherever, at whatever point, make a turnaround. The scar, at least you still have the scars, but you'll be smiling, not crying. At a certain point, Ruth was no longer crying. As you finish the book of Ruth, the Bible says that the women came to tell her how blessed she is. The same lady who was so bitter. Don't call me Naomi, call me Mara. because the Almighty has been unkind. Could you be there and you are blaming God for your circumstances, yet you are the one who made the choice? Today you can make things right. Turn it around. Make peace with God. And from that point on, you start enjoying profit. Because upon making choices, they immediately take over and start making you. And I end up by where we started. I say, the word of God makes us thoroughly equipped for every good work. You want to do good work? You need the word. You need to be thoroughly, not just haphazardly prepared. You want to be thorough. You need to be trained. You need skills. Skills distinguish you from the rest. The Bible says in Proverbs 22, verse 29, and I want us to read that verse as I sit down. Proverbs 22, verse 29. Do you see a man who excels in his work? He will stand before kings. He will not stand before unknown men. NIV, put it in NIV. Do you see a skilled man in his work? He will serve before kings. He will not serve before obscure men. We read that what the final bit, what the word of God will do, it will train you. You will become skillful. Become skillful or you will be killed. You will be eliminated. Allow the word of God to shape you, to thoroughly equip you for every good work, and you'll be a blessed man. I don't know where you think you can make things right. You can partner with God. You can cooperate with God. I don't know whether it was a teaching. I don't know whether it was a rebuke. I don't know whether it was a correction. I don't know whether it was a training. Whatever it was, I want you to stand up. And because your question paper is different, you will respond accordingly. Don't listen to your neighbor. She has a different question paper. Can we all stand up and respond to God accordingly? And as I started by saying, if you can only pick one, that is the only way you can make this day a memorial. I can assure you, you have forgotten 98% of what I said. But if you can pick one, run with it, it will change you. And you see, change will accompany you. And that is the Bible version that is needed for you, that you need. The version that will speak to you. Wanasifiwe. Want to close your eyes, reflect back, and ask yourself, what is it that I have picked today? Only one thing that you have picked today that you would want to implement, so that as a man of God, a woman of God, you can be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. What is it that you can tell God, help me on this one, it will equip me. Morning. We bless you because your word is active and alive, sharper than any two-edged sword. And this morning, Lord, we have read your word. And Lord, every brother, every sister is reasoning with you regarding one thing that they would want you to help them. I pray, because you are the one who teaches us to profit, that Lord, you will teach each one of them and help each one of them, that Lord, they will be thoroughly equipped, thoroughly empowered for every good work, every profitable work. We honor you and bless you in Jesus' name.